Okay, welcome to part two of the Inspirational Book Club. This is the November 4th meeting, number 34. And I'm very glad to say that this is the third anniversary celebration of the Inspirational Book Club. We started during the middle of the pandemic back in November of 2020. So we will soon be going into the fourth year of the Inspirational Book Club. So this is very significant. Now, the book that we're discussing, Heaven Can't Wait or Can It, the sequel, is the same book we've been discussing for the last several months. Chapter 7, pages 134 to 138. And the topic of discussion is Spiritual Awakening, Part 2, How Prayer is Related to Football. Now, this is a story in review. Number one, Aaron tells Sandra she needs a spiritual awakening as well as a physical healing. Number two, Aaron agrees to pray for and with Sandra. In our last meeting, we found that Sandra believed for her healing as a result of her prayer with Aaron. In this meeting, the discussion is about Aaron teaching Sandra the PAT principle. Now, the PAT principle is a term used in football to denote point after touchdown. And primarily it's used in professional football as far as a single point after a touchdown. But that was a few years ago. Now you could actually score 2 points after a touchdown. But any way you look at it, the PAT is a term used in football to stand for point after touchdown or points after touchdown. This was unusual advice that Aaron offered Sandra to solve her problem, that is her health problem. Now, exactly what is the PAT? Well, the P stands for pray, that is, don't forget to pray. And in our last meeting, we talked about Sandra's motivation to pray and her desire to have her prayer answered. Sandra had an opportunity to pray with her friend Maggie, but she didn't. Sandra felt a need to go all the way to Bermuda to get her problem solved. And this brings us to the first question that we have tonight. And that is, why did Sandra not talk to her friend Maggie much about her condition? And more importantly, as it relates to the PAT principle, why didn't Sandra consider Maggie to pray for her? Okay, are there any comments on that? Anybody who would like to delve into that and tell us why Sandra really didn't want to talk to her very close friend, Maggie, about her condition? Anybody?
Quick question, if I may.
Sure.
I might have just missed it, but I think in your example, I missed the what the T in the acronym stands for in the PAT. It was prayer and what were the others?
Well, the P is prayer, and we have not yet gotten to the A and the T part.
Oh, okay. I'll stay tuned for that then.
That will come later. Yeah. All right. So anyone want to try to answer that question? If not, I have my own answers. So let me go ahead and get things started with what I believe are two reasons why Sandra didn't pray with Maggie and why we hesitate to pray with another person. And the first reason is that sometimes we don't understand how God can answer a prayer. We desire an answer, that is, a healing of our situation, but in many cases, we just don't understand how it can happen. And depending on the severity of the problem, I think the thing that we do a lot of times is simply not to pray at all. We may talk to someone else about our problem, but as far as having a genuine prayer or request of God to help us in our particular situation, sometimes we don't do that. And the reason for that, I believe, or at least one reason for that, is because of the severity of our situation sometimes. We just do not see how God can help us. We know that He can help us, but we just don't see how He can help us. And so we don't address Him with that situation in many cases. Now, as believers, we know that God can heal us. I mean, we know that God can do anything. But the question is, without realizing it, sometimes we question whether God wants to heal us. Now, that is, if it's in His will to heal us. Now, let me refer to a scripture, and the scripture is James, the 4th chapter and the 2nd verse. And it says, "You do not have because you do not ask." Sandra only prayed after going to Bermuda. Again, she didn't pray with Maggie. She had a lot of opportunity to do that, but she just didn't want to talk about her situation to her very close friend. She rather wanted to go a long distance away to find some answers to her situation. And that's what she did. She went to Bermuda. Sandra still did not understand how she could be healed. So in a sense, in my opinion, I think she went on faith to Bermuda to find those answers, even though I don't think she realized it at the time, because at the time, she still had not been converted to the faith. And you can kind of understand that if you look at Isaiah, Isaiah 55th chapter, verses 8 and 9, because it says this in this verse of scripture that, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." So sometimes we really have a desire to kind of want to know how our situation can be resolved. But again, because of the severity of our situation, sometimes we just can't figure that out. And this is the reason for that, because our thoughts, our ways are not like His ways. They're so much higher than ours. Okay, so when Aaron asked Sandra if she believed what they prayed about, Sandra's response was, and I'm taking this verbatim from page 134 in the book, Sandra said, "Yes, I believe what you said in that prayer, but must tell you, Aaron, I don't understand a lot of it." So Sandra did not understand, but she did say she believed. And that's the key. So do you have any comments on that? On Sandra, despite her not understanding how her situation would be rectified, but somehow she believed Aaron when she prayed for her that her situation would be rectified. Any comments?
I like that scripture that says, "Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief." So, our belief may not be perfect. We don't understand everything, but we know someone who does understand everything.
Okay. And I think you're referring to Jesus, because He is our intercessor, intermediary. And so while we don't understand, if we have a trust in Him, then as an intercessor to God the Father, He can go to God the Father and say that, okay, this situation needs to be rectified. And because of our belief in Jesus and, of course, what He did on the earth and at the cross and His resurrection and all that, then, again, we don't necessarily have to understand everything. But we do have to believe and believe in what Jesus did when He came to the earth. Any other comments?
Yeah, I wanted to say something that's very similar to what you were saying, Pam. I've personally done a bit of Bible study of Jesus and cases where he's healed people in the Bible, and all of them follow the same trend, which we see in this story as well, where Jesus requires that we have that belief. And he also is willing to provide that for us if we ask, if we do not already have it. So there's this spiritual healing that precedes the physical healing. He wants to do the physical healing as well, but I think that he understands that the spiritual must precede that because that's the everlasting healing, and it's kind of meaningless to heal us physically if we are still spiritually broken.
Okay, good, good. Anyone else want to add to that? Okay, well, let's move on to the next segment. So Aaron not only encouraged Sandra to pray while she didn't understand, but that she should be bold in believing God will answer her prayer. And this is what it says in Hebrews, the 4th chapter, 16th verse. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So why should we come boldly? And what exactly does that mean? Anybody want to tackle that? It's not officially our next question, but I have I wanted to ask you all that, if anybody have something to say about that. Why should we come boldly? And what is that all about anyway? Coming boldly to God and requesting for a healing or something else that we might want. Any comments on that?
I would just say that the only thing I would know to do is to go by his promises. I mean, he's made several promises in the Bible, and we know that the word is true, and that's the only thing we do know, really, is the word. So we could just repeat the promises that he's given us throughout the Bible.
I guess you could argue that simply making the request is a bold action, because that step alone indicates to God that you are serious about believing that he can do what he says that he will do in the scripture. So I don't think it's necessarily a tone of voice or some other kind of physical expression, but simply asking. You can ask silently, by the way. You don't necessarily even have to speak it. If it's in your spirit, then I think that counts as coming boldly to him, because
I think boldly means trusting him and your belief and your faith that he's going to do what he says he's going to do. So I think it's a act of your faith, where you are in the relationship, and trusting that he's going to work things out for your good. So that's what I see as being bold. It's just you have to start with the faith and you trust him.
Exactly. Exactly. You trust that he is able to do what he says he will do all throughout the scripture. And all throughout the scripture, it says that he has a desire to heal us. And so the only thing we have to do is to believe that. But we'll find out a little bit later, if we have time, that there are levels to belief. And so we have to not only just believe, but we have to believe to the point where we expect God to heal us or to rectify whatever condition we might be in. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. Let's move on to that. Okay, being bold is an indication of the level of belief. So that's the next thing I was going to talk about. Being bold is an indication of the level of our belief. It's our belief at the highest level that causes God to act on our behalf. In addition to her not having an understanding of how she could be healed, The second reason why Sandra didn't pray with Maggie was because she felt uncomfortable praying with someone else. Sandra was very close to both Maggie and Maggie's mother, Mincy. But Sandra did not give Maggie the opportunity to pray with her to help her with her problems, as I mentioned earlier. So the second question is this: why did Sandra apparently feel uncomfortable praying with Maggie? Who would like to tackle that question?
I will make a comment, if you can hear me, okay?
We can.
Okay. I feel that, I don't know, I don't remember a whole lot about Maggie's character, but I think it's really important that God and our relationship with God is the number one most important relationship we have, so that you can always go to God with anything, almost to the point where it really should, you really should feel uncomfortable going to someone else rather than God first. I know God sends people and he does have us fellowship with each other. And that's the reason why, you know, that's the relationships with other people are important. But I don't know. I just feel that God, number one, should be the first go-to as far as prayer versus a person. But maybe I might be missing the character of Maggie. And so maybe that's where you were going with that question, is the reason why she wasn't comfortable with her character. But I'm just speaking in generalities, as far as going to someone outside of God first.
Well, Ponya, I think the question is not necessarily the character of Maggie. The question is the character of Sandra, which is the reason she had such character that she didn't feel comfortable praying with Maggie. And I think I worded that question correctly. Why did Sandra apparently feel uncomfortable praying with Maggie? And the reason why she did feel uncomfortable praying with Maggie was because of this. Sandra, number one, had an unhealthy relationship with Maggie's husband, Fred. If you remember, I don't want to recount the story in detail, but basically Fred had a conference in Minneapolis, and at that point Sandra wanted to be with her friend's husband. So clearly Sandra was not converted. She had these physical desires for another person, even though the person was the husband of a close friend. So she really had problems. Sandra had big problems. And the other thing is that Sandra failed to try to get any help. In other words, she continued her pursuit. And even after she was had her accident in Minneapolis, and after she was diagnosed with her situation, she continued in a very kind of, she wasn't very active because she couldn't be active in pursuing Fred at that point. But again, as Alan may have indicated, her spiritual self wasn't revived at that time. And so she still had these desires to be with Maggie's husband. And so to try to go to Maggie to have her pray for her in this situation was kind of unrealistic because of Sandra's spiritual condition. So Sandra's problem was not with unbelief necessarily. I think when she was with Aaron, Aaron fortunately helped Sandra with her belief, but she still had this situation of guilt. And that kind of continued to hinder her. And this is what it says in James, the 5th chapter, and the 16th verse. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. So you have to give an account. You have to talk to someone. It's not like necessarily putting all your business out in the street. I'm not suggesting that. But there should be somebody, someone that you can talk to help get you over the hump as far as getting that load of guilt off your chest. And it just so happens that Sandra felt that she needed to get away to do that. Any comments? All right. Sometimes we feel more comfortable in having a minister pray for us. And usually, in most cases, ministers don't know a lot of the detailed information about us, like certainly maybe family members might know. And so sometimes we feel more comfortable in going to a minister. And that's what it says in James, the 5th chapter and the 14th verse. Is any among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Now, Sandra decided to travel again all the way to Bermuda to get a solution to her problem. And she found it. She found that answer through Aaron. In addition to Sandra's comfort level, question two also involves the manner in which we pray. Sandra didn't have a history of praying with another person one-to-one. And this is taken directly from text. This is what it says. Sandra had experienced praying as a part of a group during church service or asking for a blessing over food, but she never prayed with another person one-to-one before or one-on-one before. So this leads us to our question three. And I believe this is our last question. Why don't we pray more often one-to-one with another person who may need a physical healing from an illness, like in the case of Sandra in our story? This is my take. Whether it's a pastor or, in Sandra's case, Aaron, sometimes we feel more comfortable in confiding with people who are not close to us, who are not familiar with our problems. And so I'll just leave that at that and kind of proceed on to the next letter in this PAT principle. And that is the letter A, which stands for action. And of course, what we need to do is to put action behind the prayer that we make. And we're talking about expressing your belief that your prayer will be answered. Now, you might look at prayer as an expression itself, but again, there are levels to this. What Sandra did to express her desire, well, let me rephrase that. What did Sandra do to express her desire to be healed? Well, she acted. She definitely acted. I mean, she had to book a flight, flew all the way to Bermuda to try to find some answers. She acted. That's very, very important. And God honored that action of Sandra by allowing her to cross paths with Aaron. So, are there any final comments you all would like to make regarding maybe the reason why Sandra felt that there was a need to go all the way to Bermuda to try to find some answers to her prayer? And I think the key is that she did act. Now, it may not have been the way we would act in that particular situation, but the fact of the matter is that she did act, and I believe God honored her action by having her meet Aaron, who did help her with her situation. Any comments? Final comments?
Yeah. So I like what you were saying about you know, how Sandra kind of had to get out of herself and her situation there and talk to someone who, you know, just didn't spend time with her on a regular basis. Sometimes it is easier for us to confide in people who are different or just to have some time and space away from things that are going on to be able to think about those without having it in our face every second. And I've had some people, I've had some times of my own that have been like that, but I've definitely, had some friends that recently too, that were, you know, kind of in situations like that, where it just helps to get away from chaos, you know, for a moment and be able to think through things that way.
Okay. Okay. I think another situation too with allowing our quote unquote friends to know our in-depth situation is that I believe we a lot of times have a fear of them judging us, and we don't want to be judged. What we need in situations like that is help. And I believe that's what Sandra needed and desired. And that's why she flew all the way to Bermuda to get that help. Okay. All right. Well, in our next meeting, we will complete our discussion of the PAT principle. And Alan, you mentioned the meaning of, I think you asked earlier, the P and the A. Well, we're not going to get to the T part tonight, but we will get to that in our next meeting, where our focus will be on the T part of the principle. And the title of the discussion next time will be Radical Prayer. And so this is the way we will tie the T portion of this PAT principle, and that is with what's called sometimes as radical prayer. I know I've heard of radical belief. I don't think I've heard of radical prayer before, but this is my expression, radical prayer. We'll find out what that's all about next time. And speaking of next time, the meeting will be December the 2nd, the first Saturday in December. It will be meeting number 35. And we'll still be in the book, Heaven Can't Wait, or Canon, the sequel, chapter 7. Pages 138 to 141. So I'd like to recognize the everybody for being here this evening. It's been grand. It's nice seeing you again, Alan. It's been a couple of times since we've seen you. And obviously we anticipate seeing you again on the next time. And of course, the rest of you, Pamela, Vaughn, Panya, and yours truly. So we really appreciate you being here. Before we meet again on December the 2nd, of course, we will have a Thanksgiving holiday. And so I wish everybody a nice Thanksgiving in a couple of weeks, actually, I believe. And hopefully you will not overeat and keep health in mind for just a little bit. And we still have Christmas coming up after Thanksgiving. And so this is just a season of indulgence as well as the season to recognize and to give thanks to God for what he has done for us. And particularly Christmas, of course, the coming of
I know
Jesus.
We got to get off in just a second, but everybody on this Zoom thing knows except Alan. I went through like a surgery. It was like a whirlwind. I got one call and I was having surgery in about 2 days. So like Pony said, I went to God first, because that's who you go to first if you're a believer and you trust. So that's what I did. And it's just very rare that I would go to a minister. But as I was going in Monday morning, I said, you know what? Let me text William's pastor. You went to church with us, Alan. And I texted him, and I knew what I was doing, because I said, I'm going to power off my phone. And I'm glad I stepped out of that zone where I didn't really let him in, but I didn't tell him all the details, and it was the best decision I made. Me and Will were there. I was with God talking to him, like Pontius said. And on Wednesday, I got news that I didn't want to hear, but I kept praying. He kept talking to me. He was like, make sure. He called me one day. He talked to me about 30 minutes. And I just, you know, even though I trust and I really, you know, we're really kind of private people. So Friday, so the doctor called and he was like, I want you to come over. So me and Will went over. So you want me to drive? I said, no, I'm trusting God. Basically, he's like, you're going to be okay. I said, I'm good. I'm good. It is what it is. I trusted God. Been talking to Pastor Cox and we've had good conversations where I really didn't know him before. And by the time I got there, it was the great news. I'm still going through a process, but the good news is I don't have the fatal inflammation and that we can work it out. I feel like a pharmacy, but through it all, I'm glad I did reach out to Pastor Cox, which I normally don't do, and that God is a healer, and that's what I was banking on. And he said, oh, this is reversible, but we got to go through some meds to get it cleared up. But you, if you had to have any type, you got the right one. So I am just grateful, thankful. And Pastor Cox was like, let me know how it comes out or whatever. They're really, again, not divulging all the information to him, just the things that I felt I should share with him. So like Pontius said, I trusted God. I've been praying through it, talking to William. But then something told me Monday morning going into surgery that I need to talk to someone else as well. So that's my, that's what I probably should have said in the beginning. But then we start talking about believing God. And then do you reach out to other people? So that was just a confirmation of a combination of both. You know, when I think the Spirit speaks to you, when you need to share and how much you need to share. So I wouldn't, and I let him know up front, I wasn't totally private. And he didn't even indulge in what's going on or whatever, whatever. He's just praying. And yesterday, we just kind of had a little laugh or two about it. But in the end, it worked out, got a process, but God is faithful, so I'm trusting him through the reversal. Okay? That is it.
Oh, great.
But, Alan, I missed you. I asked him. I was looking for you Thursday.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mentioned that to Alan.
We'll see you soon, though, somewhere.
Yeah, for sure. And thank you for sharing that story with us, or with me. I'm sure the rest of y'all have heard, but I'll definitely keep praying and praise God that
All right. Well, listen, thank you all. And as usual, if you'd like to hang on for another few minutes, you can turn your picture off and listen to some music for the next minute or two. All right. So see you all next time. Happy Thanksgiving. And we'll see you at that time. Night, night.